Hello there, my name is Pastor Buck Wilford. I'm the pastor here at Brunswick Community Church. We're located right in the Rito's Bakery Plaza at 1930 Pearl Road. We have church at 10 a.m. on Sundays and Bible study at 6:30 p.m. on Thursdays. We also have good Christian education hour at 9 a.m. Sundays if you want to come a little early. We're a church that loves people and we love God. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to meet you. We'd love to just be a part of your life as well too. We're focused in on preaching the Bible. I do it verse by verse, expository style. We hold to the five solas. We believe strongly that we're saved only by grace alone, through faith alone, through Christ alone. And it's all to the glory of God alone. And the only thing we hold as infallible and inerrant and strongly adhere to is the scriptures alone. We'd love to see you out here. We'd love to have you come visit. Thank you so much.
On this membership papers, but who's this?
Some of you guys already give me a membership papers. I got X, I got other people's, I got some from before, if you've had this for a while, but we wanted to get this updated and get it going through. This didn't change at all, but just to make sure that we have it. So I have these papers here for them, okay? So if you need some, you let me know. And today, we are in toward the end of July. Okay, this is like I think July 23rd today.
One more Sunday still,
so it's not potluck nut Sunday, but let me think about it. The end of July already. I mean, it's, you gotta enjoy it, because you know our summers, our time is short. Every year it's the same, right? We repeat time, but think about this. The more I keep repeating, the more I realize just how it's gone, you know? So you wanna do summer stuff? Do the summer stuff. Because in a few more months, it won't be summer. We know that from being in Ohio. And in fact, I know for sure, just watching things, and maybe it's the same what you've noticed, at Memorial Day weekend, which is right at the beginning of June, end of May, that's when pools open. When do they shut? The first week of September, Labor Day weekend. Why? Because it gets too cold to swim usually after that. We still have some warm days, but... All year long they have ice cold water, but thank God we have some warm water for 3 months. So let's try to enjoy your summers and make the most of it. I tell you, the more I read my Bible, the more I see life, the more I'm a chaplain and I see a lot of death and things, the more I realize just how valuable every single day is. And that's so important. And the saddest thing is when you see people not realize that or get that like epiphany until there's just a couple days left, or no days left, you know? And so let's try to grab that epiphany now and live it out and enjoy the good weather, enjoy the summer, enjoy the fellowship we have with one another, enjoy the days that we have. Of course, there's always going to be bad stuff because we live on the broken side of heaven. So we can't get past the bad, broken stuff. But trying to make the most of the good stuff and soak it in and let it be. And don't let that bad stuff destroy all the times you can have for the good times. There's a great sermon today. Not that I made a great sermon, but then Jesus gave a great sermon. And we're going to read about it. And I'm gonna read it right here. It's Luke 5, 1 to 11. I'm going to give announcements. So I got excited. I'm going to do this first. But this is a great sermon. Let me read this. It says, "Now it happened that while the crowd was pressing around him and listening to the word of God, he was standing at the edge of the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats lying at the edge of the lake, and the fishermen, having gotten out of them, were washing their nets. And he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little way from the land. And he sat down and began teaching the crowds from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, 'Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch.' Simon answered and said, 'Master, we labored all night and caught nothing, but at your word I will let down the nets.' And when they had done this, they enclosed a great quantity of fish, and their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat for them to come and help them, and they came and filled both of the boats, so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw this, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man.' For amazement had seized him and all companions because of the catch of the fish which they had taken. And James and John, the son of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon, were also likewise amazed And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not fear, for from now on you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to the land, they left everything and followed him. Oh, let me tell you, this is good stuff. I'm telling you, I hope you get as excited about today as I'm about it. It's good stuff. And with the rest of the announcements, I already skipped ahead just to read the passage, is we have Bible study at 6:30. We're in Jude, verse 11. Okay? This one little chapter of Jude, one little book, only one chapter, is taking some time. It could take a lot longer than that, really, but it's taking some time. We had quite some discussions between verse 5 and 10 this last week. But it's good stuff. But verse 11, so we're here at 6:30, and we do our best to finish at about 8. Lately, we have been finishing the study at 8. We've been finishing the study at 8. We've been praying until 8:30 or somewhere longer, and then fellowshipping as well, too. So we are getting better. We have been finishing our Bible talk today, all right? And if you need to leave, you can leave. It's okay. We don't need to, if you can't stay late later. But I am always home between 9 and 9:30. So, but we're getting there toward 8 to be more succinct. But it is beautiful fellowship. And I tell you, in our busy lives, it is such a refreshment and encouragement to go to a Bible study and get that one-on-one beautiful fellowship with one another where you can speak and be heard, you can flesh things out, you can ask questions, you dig deep, people talk back and forth, and then pray for one another. It's a good thing. And then the other announcement is on next Sunday after this is going to be Communion Sunday, and the Sunday after that is going to be the potluck, which would be a barbecue and also a pie contest. And we've already got two people signed up for pies, and we got to remind you, don't buy a pie for the pie contest, okay? You got to make a pie for the pie contest, all right? And that's what we're going to do, so it'll be a lot of fun. Yeah, we don't want to judge the store. All right. And I think that might be it for announcements. Anybody else think of announcement? Something? I got this boat issue. Yes, one sign over here. That's not a permanent feature in the church. But I got blessed from Linda with some signs, and I got a sign for Tom here. Don't take his sign. That's Tom's sign. But it's a good thing to stand up with right there, okay? Because I tell you, it really does come down right now. I mean, there's other issues at stake and everything, too. The big picture is the right thing to do. But right now, really, we want to make sure our children are safe in our schools from getting taught perverted things. And we also want to make sure that our we don't start killing babies like it's going out of style. We want to keep trying to go the other way and not kill any babies. You know, it's truly, it's like what Ricky, if you talk to Ricky, calls himself an abolitionist. It means no killing babies, no abortion whatsoever. That's the where we want to get to right there. That's the fight. We don't want to be like, let's make a law where we can just go the other way killing more babies. And that's really what this will come down to in the end. But with all that, I think that's it. If you'll stand, we'll pray. And after we pray, we're going to sing some hymns, and then we're going to hear a good passage preached. Oh, it's good. I hope I can do it justice. I hope so. Let me bow your heads, please. Father God, I thank you so much for this day, and I thank you for every single person who's here today, Lord. I thank you for your mercy, for your grace. I thank you for the very breath of life that you give us, Lord, sinners, Lord, people who sin, people who disobey a holy God and do the things that his enemy would have them to do, Lord. And yet you love us and let you show us grace. And yet we can come before you, Lord, and worship you and find forgiveness and confess our sins and be before you, Lord, in a way of peace and know that you love us, that you love us so much that you died for us while we were still sinners, Lord. And Lord, I ask that you be with us this day. Help us, Lord, to value you at the utmost of all things in our lives and above, Lord. And help us, Lord, to be able to concentrate on you this day as we sing these hymns in worship of you and as we hear your word preached. Help us to set aside all the troubles and all the things in this world that occupy our minds and get us so distracted so often. And help us, Lord, to focus in on you. Speak to us, Lord Jesus, by the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray all these things in Jesus' holy and mighty name. Amen. Remain standing if you're able to. If not, it's okay to sit down.
Quite a bit last week. So today we're going to have two songs you're very familiar with, and the other one I I challenged you last week with, we're going to repeat. So, we're going to 105. First, 105, 105.
God. Oh.
have a couple of service announcements, I guess. I just saw on TV, and it's standing right in front of me, vote yes on issue one. If you watch the commercials, my background is in criminal justice, constitutional law, and it hurts me when I see the commercials saying that if you vote no or you vote yes, you'll strip away your constitutional amendments, the majority. Voting yes actually expands the majority, so I really don't like those commercials at all. It's blatant lying. If anybody hasn't, I don't usually recommend too many movies publicly or anything like that, but The Sound of Freedom, I watched that. That was, I've seen stuff like that occur in some of the other countries, probably Buckcast too, where you kind of question what's going on, you report it, and you pray that something good happens. But if you want to see a good movie that's based on the truth, and it's almost like the 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon, I know an investigator that actually knows the one that that story is based on. So it was a good movie. I ended up watching it with him and a couple of people, so really good movie. You have to go in with an open mind, so maybe some tissues, and you probably walk out very somber, because it still goes on today. Slave labor, sex trafficking, human trafficking, it's horrible. And I was glad that the movie can get it to life. But we're on chapter 4 today. And I was going back and restudying, and I was going through my notes, and then my notes got thrown away at the hotel while I was gone. I think if you want to understand the background, where we're at, we're only through 4 chapters, but so much, we're going on chapter 4. But to understand the early chapters, maybe the entire book, we can look at verse 2 in chapter 1. And I quote chapter 1, verse 2 of Daniel. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judea, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. His, that's being Nebuchadnezzar. By this symbolic act, King Nebuchadnezzar asserted that his gods were greater than Yahweh, God himself. Nebuchadnezzar was greater than God himself. His gods are greater. So this takes us all through to where we're at in chapter 4. We should know through reading the Bible all through. We know we just had a discussion earlier. Not everybody reads the Bible all the way through. That God allows evil people to triumph over his people. We see it time and time and again. Nebuchadnezzar thought he was stronger than the Most High God. The Most High God wasn't used too often, but in chapter 3, and then we're going to talk about it in 2 parts here in chapter 4, but we're going to circle back to the Most High God. God, through the first 3 chapters, has been trying to reach Nebuchadnezzar. And then we see this contrast on how we fight through adversity. Remember I said this is our living through adversity with our faith, obedience. We see the response of Nebuchadnezzar with his adversity and how he responds in anger or hate, or can use all his powers that he thinks he has. Remember, he is very prideful. He's elevated in status. He defeated the nation of Israel. He thinks his gods are giving him all this power. But we see Daniel. We see his 3 companions. When they're faced with adversity, their obedience in God and faith and prayer, no matter what it is. We saw in chapter 1, right? We go back to the foundation, prophecies. We knew God, the prophets, told us that this would happen to Israel, and it did. And Daniel didn't defile himself when he was captured. He refused to eat the king's table, which the king's table is great food, the best of the best. But because of obedience, in verse 17 in chapter 1, God gave them the knowledge. We know Daniel in Daniel 3 complains to finish, he'll finish this.
he rose up, he's willing to take this knowledge and wisdom and use it within his faith and obedience. And like you said, we see this contrast. Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar, faith and obedience, for I'm trying to use myself, I'm greater than out. Two, we saw the dream and the vision, right? The Chaldeans always pumping his ego, but we saw a change in Nebuchadnezzar a little bit. He did not trust his wise men, right? He's going to kill them all. Daniel, without regard of his own life, wished to speak to Nebuchadnezzar. Didn't know what was going on. The captain of the guard told Daniel what was going on, and what did Daniel immediately do? He went to prayer, right? God, you know, went to his companions. God, it's in your hand. Spoke to Nebuchadnezzar, gave him this dream, gave him the dream of the four parts, the five parts of the golden statue, explained to Nebuchadnezzar that he was ahead. We see Nebuchadnezzar starting to recognize God. Not coming to God, just recognizing this power, right? Because immediately in chapter 3, what does he do? He decides to build a statue, all of gold. Apparently he did not get the message, right? We saw Daniel get promoted. We saw chapter 3, you know, Daniel wasn't present. We kind of explained that the best possible options where Daniel was. Probably he was away doing the king's business. Also, the king knew Daniel provided these interpretations and visions. We see the two, but how many more did Daniel give King Nebuchadnezzar? We don't know. Like I said, chapter 3, that recognition of God was short-lived, because Nebuchadnezzar decided to build a statue all of gold. He called everybody to come to worship this. He had a fiery furnace burning. Can you imagine that going on? You're called, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, we're having pizza? No. If you disobey me, you're going into that fire. And we saw Daniel's three companions refuse to go. Not refuse in a way that were like, I don't want to go to the store with you, mom or dad. Refused because, one, they were commanded to by God, right? The commandment. No other image. They didn't bow down. These three did not know what their outcome was, and they put their faith, and they were willing to die or have a miracle happen because of their faith. You see, they become unbounded there in the cast. Nebuchadnezzar lost his own men. He was puzzled. He asked twice, did I see four people? Didn't we cast them down? Didn't we cast them down? Weren't they bonded? But not. They didn't even come out smelling like smoke. How many of you barbecued, grilled, started a fire? Maybe only been there for a couple of minutes. You smell like smoke, right? To not smell like smoke. And then the fourth person. And we see at the end of chapter 3, once again, further recognition of God, but Nebuchadnezzar didn't include himself when he said the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He's still not there. And that takes us to chapter 4. It has to do with a vision, but seen against his background from chapter 1 and 3. We gotta keep all that in the context where we're going in chapter 4. God works in his own time, in his own plan. And if you really read the dream, there's so much intensity of this dream that we're going to see. And for time's sake, I'm just going to read a little bit as we go, if everybody's okay with that. I'd like just to thank everybody for being with me as I try to figure out different teaching styles and everything. I'm just trying to figure it out through God's will, right? We'll get started. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this blessed day, this beautiful day that we gather to study your word as we go through the book of Daniel. Pray that you help me speak with clarity and speak through me, Lord. That you be with us, open our ears to the message that you, the Holy Spirit, ordained through the word of God and the book of Daniel. And that bless everyone, safe travel as they come to service here later, Lord. Be with us in this hour. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. So let me read the first three verses. We're on chapter 4. King Nebuchadnezzar, to all peoples, nations, and language that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied to you. It has seemed good to me to show the signs and wonders that the Most High God has done for me. I'm going to stop right there. Verse 26. This is why I can't always trust commentary. It said this is the first time it was addressed, but if you look at chapter 3, verse 26, Nebuchadnezzar came near the door of the burning fire furnace, and he declared Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego servants of the Most High God. But the Most High God, here in chapter 4, we're going to see this six times. And I'm going to explain a little bit here, like part one, and hopefully it makes sense when we get later in the verse. And then we'll finish three. How great are his signs, how mighty his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion endures from generation to generation. He said, Most High God, we'll see this six times. Like I said, we first saw chapter 3, verse 26. So what does this signify? This is an open question. The Most High God, what is Nebuchadnezzar's change here? Do you see a change in Nebuchadnezzar? I mean, if we read all of chapter 4, you know, he didn't learn too much, but he's going to get a great lesson. And you're going to see a turn that maybe if you didn't read Daniel before, it was completely unexpected. But what does this signify? You can see the Most High God in Genesis 14:20. I might be wrong, but this is the first time I saw the reference when Abraham returned from the battle against the kings, and he had a meeting with Melchizedek, if I'm saying that right. And we were told he was the priest of the Most High God, ruler of heaven and earth. Not that the priest was the ruler of heaven and earth, but he served the ruler of the Most High God, ruler of heaven and earth. And this reference, and bear with me, is not as God's role as redeemer or his wisdom, but is his sovereignty. In Isaiah 14, we were given the description of Satan's thoughts. As Satan said, he wished to be the Most High God. Verses 13 to 14, I will ascend to heaven, raise my throne above the stars of God. Verse 14, I will make myself like the Most High God. Look what was absent and what he did not wish to be. Satan and Nebuchadnezzar, we're going to see this connection. At first, Nebuchadnezzar did not want to be, he wanted to be the Most High God, but he doesn't want to be the Redeemer. He doesn't want to have the wisdom of God. He wants to be sovereign of all. This is Nebuchadnezzar's, kryptonite, I want to say. He thinks he's powerful, he's prideful, and I want to make that connection because we can see that in Isaiah, we can see that in Genesis, the Most High God. And I don't want to confuse you all. I'm going to connect this a little bit later so we can go further in the dream in verses 28 through 30. So let's read 4 through 9. I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at ease in my house and prospering in my palace. I saw a dream that made me afraid. As I lay in bed, the fancies and the visions of my head alarmed me. So I made a decree that all the wise men of Babylon should be brought before me, and they made known to me the interpretation of the dream. Then the magicians, the enchanters, the Chaldeans, the astrologers came in, and I told them the dream, but they could not make known to me its interpretation. At last, Daniel came in before me, who was named Belteshazzar, after the name of my God, and in whom the spirit of the holy gods. And I told him the dream, saying, O Belteshazzar, chief of magicians, because I know that the spirit of the holy gods is in you, that no mystery is too difficult for you. Tell me the visions of my dream, and I saw their interpretation. So Nebuchadnezzar in 9, God's working in him. Notice he's alarmed. He's already had some of the visions. He knows something's going on. He's alarmed. He's worried. and spiritual. But unlike before, he called his enchanters, he told them the dream. But his anger is not there, right? But really we see he's more prideful and boastful. He's prospering in his palace. Like the finite details there. And this time he told the magicians, but he knew he would not get the answer, and he came back to Daniel. But he still, as you can see, he still makes a reference to Nebuchadnezzar. He's worshiping those little gods. He's still placing his little gods in himself before, but he has the recognition of what Daniel's God is doing. And he recognizes that the God of gods dwells within Daniel to get this interpretation. Now let's read this dream, this vision. The vision of my height was great. The tree grew and became strong, and its top reached to the heaven, and it was visible to the end of the whole earth. Its leaves were beautiful and its fruit abundant, and it was in it for food for all. The beasts of the field make shade under it, and the birds of the heavens lived in its branches, and the flesh was fed from it. I saw in the visions of my head as I lay in bed, behold, a watcher, a holy one, came down from heaven. He proclaimed aloud, thus, chop down the tree and lop off its branches, strip off its leaves and scatter its fruit. Let the beasts flee from under it and the birds from its branches, but leave the stump of its roots and the earth bound with a band of iron and bronze. Amid the tender grass of the field, let him be wet with the dew of heaven. Let his portion be with the beasts and the grass of the earth. Let his mind be changed from a man's, and let a beast's mind given to him. And let 7 periods pass over him. The sentence is by decree of the watchers, decisions of the world, the holy ones, to end that the living may know the Most High. Rules in the kingdom of men, and gives it to whom he will, and sets over the lowliest of men. A dream I, King Nebuchadnezzar, saw, and you, O Belshazzar, tell me the interpretation, because all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make known to me this interpretation, but you are able, for the spirit of the holy gods is in you. Once again, at the end of this dream, you can see the fear that King Nebuchadnezzar has, but the recognition that the Holy Spirit lies into it. But Nebuchadnezzar is blinded, right? He can't see this interpretation. Not, as we can see, it's not Daniel has any magical powers, but it's his faith and obedience that God granted this wisdom. So now, verse 19 through 27, we'll see this interpretation. Then Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, was dismayed for a while, and his thoughts alarmed him. Even Daniel was alarmed by this vision, because he knew what it meant. The king answered and said, Belshazzar, let not the dream or the interpretation alarm you. Belshazzar answered you, my lord, may the dream be for those who hate you, and its interpretation for your enemies. The tree you saw, which grew and became strong, so that its tops reached to the heaven, and it was visible to the end of the whole earth, whose leaves were beautiful, and its fruit abundant, in which the food for all, under which the beasts of the field found shade, and whose branches were the birds heavens lived. It is you, O king. You have grown and become strong. Your greatness has grown to reaches of heaven, and your dominion to the ends of earth. And because the king saw a watcher, a holy one, coming down from heaven, saying, chop down the tree and destroy it, but leave the stump of its roots bound with a band of iron and bronze. And the tender grass of the field, let it be wet with the dew of heaven. And let this portion be with the beasts of the field till the 7 periods of time pass over him. This is the interpretation, O king. It is the decree of the Most High, which has come upon my lord, the king, that you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. You shall be made to eat grass like an ox, and you shall be wet with the dew of heaven, and 7 periods of time shall pass over you, till you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men, and gives it to whom he will. And as it was commanded to leave the stump of the root of the tree, your kingdom shall be confirmed for you from the time that you know heaven rules. Therefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable to you. break off from your sins by practicing righteousness and your iniquities by showing mercy to the oppressed, that there may perhaps be a lengthening of your prosperity. Daniel's giving King Nebuchadnezzar this warning. Go away from your sins. Turn away from what you do. You may be granted further prosperity. As we already read in the first three chapters, Daniel's told Nebuchadnezzar, God has ordained you. Right? So we already know this. God has ordained Nebuchadnezzar as king. God used Nebuchadnezzar to take and rule over the nation of Israel and take them into exile. Why? To fulfill God's prophecy. Verse 19, Daniel was even appalled and alarmed. The king didn't demand the answer. You notice a little change? He actually almost like he was comforting Daniel. He wants to know. And he wants the truth. But I made a note, was he ready for the truth? He wants the truth, but was he ready for the truth? And then verse 20, Daniel tells us this dream that the tree is Nebuchadnezzar. The sky was visible, and God has exalted him. God exalted Nebuchadnezzar to be this great figure. He told it to him in the first dream. Verse 23, pride has to be cut down, but the stump remains. He's not going to understand this. And verse 25, he's going to become beastly. And then, like I said, in verse 27, Daniel warns him to break away. Like, God gave you this vision and this dream and allowed me to interpret it. You know, go away. Turn away from your sin. Come to the Most High God. Listen to him. But as we go to verse 28 and 29, all this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar at the end of the 12 months. He was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon, and the king answered, "Is this not great Babylon, which I have built my mighty power as a royal residence for the glory of the majesty?" Woo! So a year has gone by. I think Pastor Buck talks to us about this all the time. God works on his own time and his own plan. Still had a year. Probably still prideful and boastful through those years. Sure, Daniel's continually counseling Nebuchadnezzar, you could assume. But here we are, King Nebuchadnezzar, knowing this dream, already seeing God, the Most High God, act in that fiery furnace with Daniel's three companions. That fourth figure, as he even said, is like a son of God. It had to be that image. Yet Nebuchadnezzar is very prideful. Have we all seen this? I mean, a few weeks ago I cleaned out an area, put some rock down, some fabric, and I looked at it and I was like, man, I really did a good job. But I was already reading ahead, I was like, whoa. Thank God for this for you. You know, so you have to take the moment and recognize God's will, his grace, and his mercy to allow you to do these things. I was talking to Ricky, I ran into a gentleman. The next part of the story is punishment, and it is significant. God didn't go down a list and say, oh, let's eeny, meeny, miny, moe this to Nebuchadnezzar. Everything that God does is significant and has his ordained purpose. He lowered him from the pinnacle of pride to the baseness of insanity and associated with beasts and behaved like one. God saying by that punishment is the result when men and women give glory of God to themselves, they become beast-like. Maybe not to an extent that we saw Nebuchadnezzar, but there's this reference. In fact, this is worse because at least beasts, when they are beasts, they're acting like how God has ordained them, right? So if a man or a woman is acting like a beast, then there is even a greater punishment. They're acting worse because that beast, that rat, is acting like a rat. I got a story, Dr. John Gershner. I found while I was going through this, he was Dr. Sproul's, you know, his mentor, mentee, And it got to a video, it was more like an audio, but he was doing a speech, Reformed Theology on Human Depravity. And during it, he made that reference that men and women are like rats. So time went on, and it finished, and they had a question and answer time. And a man stood up and he goes, "I demand you to apologize," right? "I demand you to apologize." Christian was like, "Oh, I prophetically apologize. I apologize to the rats." And the guy was puzzled. And the guy's like, "This is unfair. You're comparing us to a rat. Like, how is the rat to be apologized to and not me for comparing it?" He said, "To show what a rat does is by the gift of God. So when a rat acts like a rat, it's acting through its gift of God. But when we behave and act like a rat, it is for the worse, and we should apologize to God because we are now acting like those rats." I was like, oh, what a connection here. Like, don't act like an animal, you'll be treated like an animal. You ever hear that analogy? When men and women take glory to themselves, you see this in Romans 1. He doesn't give us up to nothing, but knows all his time. Every time there's a reference like this, Nebuchadnezzar, Romans 1, what are they doing? They're turning from God, right? God will turn from them, those who don't believe. But I found through this connection for the light bearer and how we should act. Not like beasts, like I don't want to focus on the negativity. But let me get through this connection and maybe a debate. When I spoke about Satan earlier and his rebellion, you know, in Isaiah 14, there's more to this. I pointed out that his own sin was taking God's glory for his own, right? We see this with Nebuchadnezzar, we see this with many. Paul writes in Romans 1. People throughout history keep doing this, and we don't learn, right? I don't know why people don't want to learn. I think it's an easy principle. But if you want to see the role, let's look at Ezekiel 28. What was Satan doing with God before he fell? The prophet Ezekiel in chapter 28 describes Satan as standing on the holy mount of God, directing the worship of creation to God and interpreting demands of God to the creation. His name was Lucifer. It means light bearer. He bore the worship of creation with God and reflected God's image back to creation. This is our role. It was Daniel's role. He was the light bearer. It was his three companions. It's our role out there in a wicked world. This is our role, not to take glory, but rather achieve everything we do in the praise, Lord. Be as moral as we possibly can. Do as well as we can possibly can. So when we are successful and trying to be most moral as we can, we point to God and say, "It is not I, but it is Christ who works in me." Let's be that light bearer. I think Nebuchadnezzar finally got it. He confessed. Boy, did he take a long, dark path to get there. Let's not go through that path. Let's be a light bearer. Let's be those Daniels, but we don't know what God's plan is to bring somebody to Christ, right? There's reference to Christ even in Daniel. In verse 37, like I said, that was the last time the words we hear from Nebuchadnezzar, where it says, "I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the kingdom of heaven." I like to end right there. As we've gone through the first four chapters of Daniel, and we saw Nebuchadnezzar in the contrast of obedience and faith. And we know Daniel and his three friends, no doubt, probably in heaven today. But do you think that of Nebuchadnezzar? Did his path take him to a different light? God used him for his prophecy, to fulfill prophecy. But as we can see, God's ordainment and will was so much that he even humbled this horrific and brought him down to shambles, made him a beast. Oh Lord, I don't want to be a. I hope I was never that much of a beast. But question out there, what do you think on that final verse? We never hear from Nebuchadnezzar again. Do you think Nebuchadnezzar saw the light and he's in heaven? So we do not know, as we are the light bearers walking around this earth, that the most wicked people on this earth can come and come towards the light. So remember every day when we walk, and we walk our faith, to be cognizant of how we say what we do, because you don't know who's listening. You don't know who's paying attention. Who cares? This is what he's saying. Who cares how wicked and evil Nebuchadnezzar was? You don't know what's going to humble them and bring them to Christ at the end of the day. Amen. All right. Anybody have any questions, comments? I know there's a little debate, but that's how I felt when I read. I had a couple of weeks to read it. The housekeeper actually threw away my first notes. So I must have not got a good interpretation. I was humble. I was going all over the place. I was like, oh my gosh. And then I wrote it again and couldn't read my notes. But you don't know how God's going to work in there. And to find that connection of some of the two most horrific people in the world, like Satan and Nebuchadnezzar, that you can use in a positive light, just brought a little bit of change and connection in me, and I hope it does to you. And next week we'll go into chapter 5. This is the handwriting on the wall. Nebuchadnezzar has lost his kingdom. We'll see Belzar. There's a lot of historical, secular confrontation with that chapter and why it's him. But we all know, like kings, when they go out, back then the kings actually went out and they left their sons or their right hand man in charge. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And I'll let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your words. And I pray that I can be that light bearer, that I take the log out of my own eye and not be as prideful, and give all the glory to you, Lord. And I pray that everyone here today, anybody that was listening, anybody that was watching, do the same thing. I know I'm not perfect, and it was something I need to strive and work towards, Lord, but I know I can do that with you and through you. Dear Lord, please pray for Pastor Buck as he comes up. We have a great service. Just be with us today in the great fellowship, and pray that everyone has a joyous and wonderful day. In Jesus' heavenly name, we pray. Amen.
Enterprise. Is this good?